When designing and building a high-end car audio system, we know that the speaker position and direction of those speakers in the front of the vehicle is very important. We would never take one of these speakers and face it away from our listening position, yet with subwoofers, it's common to have them facing backwards, facing upwards. Why is that? Have we been doing this wrong all along? I'm Mark, welcome to Car Audio Fabrication, the show where together we learn how to master car audio and how to design, build, and install our dream car audio system. And in this video, we're gonna dive in and take a look. Before we get into our topic, I do want to take a quick second to thank our monthly channel sponsor, New Concepts. When we're installing a subwoofer into the vehicle, of course we need a way to send the power signal from our amplifiers to that subwoofers, and to do so, I recommend this right here, the Karma Series speaker cable. This wire is oxygen-free copper and of a twisted pair design. Now you can get this in the usual sizes of 16 gauge, 14 gauge, 12 gauge, 10 gauge, but check this out, you can even get it in this absolutely monstrous 8 gauge, which is super nice. It's nice and flexible, perfect for those high power applications. Also in the Karma series, they have this bi-wire cable. This gives you four conductors. That way you could do a set of two-way components in a door. You could have signal going to your woofer and signal going to your tweeter with this cable. To learn more, check out the links down in the video description. So to get started with determining if we've been facing our subwoofers the wrong direction all along, we have to understand how human hearing works. With the basics of human hearing, we know that we can hear low frequency sounds like those of a subwoofer, and we can also hear mid-range and high-end sounds like those of a tweeter. Our brain is able to interpret the rate at which our eardrums are vibrating and interpret that frequency in what we hear. But if we close our eyes and we are in a room and somebody does a high frequency noise like a whistle, we can very easily identify where that high frequency noise is coming from. Whereas if it's a low frequency noise, it is much harder to do so. To understand why this is, we need to understand how localization of a sound source works for our hearing. So let's start with a little test. Close your eyes and you can snap your fingers at random locations around your head. Now, obviously you're doing the snapping so you can hear where it's coming from, but even if you have somebody help you out with this and they do the snapping, it's very easy to know where that snap is. In order for our brain to determine where that snap is coming from, it has to do an analysis of our eardrums, which are the brain's sensors for audio. And our brain is going to do that analysis in a couple of different directions. The first direction is my left and my right. So how does our brain determine if the sound is to our left or to our right? It actually uses a couple of different methods. The first method our brain uses is an analysis of the loudness of that sound. If I whisper, the sound is obviously quieter. And I'm not gonna do it, but if I were to yell right now, your brain would obviously be able to interpret that as well. Our brain is able to perceive these different levels of loudness independently in both of our ears. And we all know that the loudness of a sound changes with distance. Obviously, if you have your ear really close to a speaker, it's gonna be incredibly loud. But if you're further away, obviously, not as loud. So when something happens on my left side, my left ear is going to hear that sound slightly louder than my right ear. And my brain can interpret that in order to locate that noise. Our brain's ability to do this is called ILD, or interaural level difference. Now, the second way our brain can determine the location of a sound is based on time. Although the speed of sound is fast at 767 miles per hour in room temperature air, our brain can still interpret things very, very quickly. If a snap occurs on the left side of my head, my left ear is going to hear that milliseconds before my right ear. And thus, I can also locate that sound based on that difference. This is called ITD, or interaural time difference. So ILD and ITD allow us to determine sounds on left and right, and we as humans, obviously we have a sensor on the left and right side of our head, so we are much more easily able to determine location of sound left and right. And as you know, we don't have a sensor on the top of our head or in our chin, so we're gonna have a harder time determining the sound height, in other words, up and down, which is the next direction I wanna talk about. Before we move on, kind of a fun fact here, now that you understand ITD and ILD, part of the reason that a dog has a tendency to turn their head when you make a funny noise or when you're talking to them is their primal nature has wired them to reorient their sensors to try to get a better feel for the environment and what is going on. So getting back into it, we know that our brains are wired to correctly identify left and right, and we are very easily able to do this for mid-range and higher frequency sounds. But why do we have trouble doing it for low frequency sounds. The reason boils down to the way that frequency or wavelengths work. I did a quick measurement and the distance between my eardrums is about 8 inches. Without getting too far off topic, a very basic fact about the way that waves work is the longer a wavelength is, the lower frequency it is, and the smaller a wavelength is, the higher frequency it is. So with mid-range speakers, the frequencies tend to be a little bit larger or starting to approach the distance between our two sensors, so our brain really relies on the ITD, the interaural time difference, in order to localize that sound. Now, as we get into the high frequency sounds, like those from a tweeter, the wavelengths become very small. In layman's terms, it becomes much more difficult for our brain to understand that phase relationship because now that wavelength is smaller than our two sensors, so we rely much more upon the ILD, the interaural level difference, in order to locate high frequencies. Now, understanding that, I do want to point out a super juicy tidbit of information here, and this is a question I get quite often. Let's say that you're doing a passive set of components, and you have a mid-range speaker and you have a tweeter, and these are on a passive crossover, which means you only have one amplifier channel going to them, which means you can only control that one channel on the DSP. Now, say that these are in two different locations. Should you do time alignment to the mid-range speaker or to the tweeter? Well, we just talked about how with the mid-range frequencies, our ears rely more upon that time difference, so you're usually going to want to time delay to the larger of the two speaker locations, the one that's going to be playing more of the mid-range notes. Now, as we start to get into the low frequency sounds that our subwoofer is playing, that wavelength becomes so long that it is far, far longer than the distance between our two sensors. As an example, an 80 hertz tone can be around 169 inches of wavelength in room temperature air. So with that long of a wavelength, neither of our two methods, the ILD or ITD, really work as effectively to locate that sound. We've really gone into detail on understanding how we hear left and right, but obviously when we do that exercise with somebody snapping, we can locate up and down, and we can also locate in front and behind us. The reason we can do this is our brain has trained itself to understand how sound is impacted by the shape of our ears. Throughout our whole life, our brain has been calibrating itself. It's taken what it's seen with your eye sensors and it's correlated that sound with your ear sensors and it's dialed that in and calibrated to determine when I see something right here, I know that I'm hearing it right here as well. These sensors become so fine-tuned that you can literally shut off your eye sensors and you can determine where something is in space around you based literally on how that sound sounds. Now, when something occurs behind us, a high frequency sound has more of a tendency to wrap itself around the shape of your ear and be interpreted by your eardrum. The same is true for an acoustic environment of a vehicle. Those high frequency sounds can really bounce around quite a bit, and we always want to take that into account. Now, again, in layman's terms, these low frequency sounds don't seem to have that same tendency with their longer wavelength, and they become harder to localize for that fact because they don't really conform themselves or change much to the shape of your ear. Additionally, we all know that subwoofers are usually placed where they have more room for their airspace in the back of the vehicle. And since our ears face forwards on our heads, we do a much better job of localizing sound in front of us versus behind us. So for these reasons, locating the subwoofer behind us is far more difficult, and why we can create a natural sounding environment that performs well with a subwoofer facing many different directions in the back of a vehicle. Now, I do have two more videos I want to give you guys that if you enjoyed this topic, I think you will really like. But really quick question of the episode, which direction is your subwoofer facing in your vehicle? I want to be clear that yes, I understand that the direction your subwoofer is facing can have an impact on the actual performance of your system, but it doesn't impact how we actually hear that performance, how we actually hear the sound. And that's why, in summary, all these things I talked about in this video, it's okay to have those subwoofers facing away from you in the back of the vehicle. Now, I do have a video about how to determine the best way to face your subwoofers in your vehicle, and I also have another video that's about crossovers and, more importantly, how to avoid a phenomenon called beaming. You do not want your speakers to be beaming in your system, and if you can avoid it, you can really get high-end sound performance. I'll link both of those at the end of this video. A special thanks to monthly channel sponsor New Concepts. Learn more about the Karma series of speaker wire at the links down in the video description. Also, a special thanks to Bryson, Mike, Ali, Jerry, Marcos, William, and the rest of the Patreon membership team. A big thanks to all of those guys for making these videos possible. And my dudes, thank you guys for watching.